welcome back from the break. Now, engaging in dairy farming without prior knowledge on how to manage it could leave you cursing. But with research, planning, and focus, you could break even. This week, we visit a farmer in Barra who says that formal employment is not the epitome of success and also advises young people to engage in commercial agriculture.
I'm called Otega Daniel Kajira. I'm a farmer. My farm is called Abato Dairy Farm. We mainly focus on dairy farming. And the main farmer, the former director was late Kajira. D. Kajira is a retired captain and he joined into farming and now I'm the one who manages the farm as their last born son. And we're doing farming as a family business. And we mainly focus on dairy cows, Frisians. And we have started having Frisians and other exotic breeds as a farm. We have some few challenges. And one of the challenges is diseases in cows, East Coast fever. East Coast fever, foot and mouth disease, drought. Like in Uganda, we have challenges of drugs. Drugs are a bit, they have affected them, but we are looking for a way we can use other companies so that they can give us good drugs. And I'm also a member of one of the biggest cooperatives in Uganda. It's called the West Ghana Kashai Dairy Farmers Cooperative Society, and it is in here in Biharwe. The size of my farm is located in Biharwe, Wenjeru. It's on 110 acres, and we have banana plantations, we have a mango project, we also have dairy farmers, dairy cows. So we collect milk, we milk cows. After milking the cows, we take them to the cooperative. One of the biggest cooperative, West Ghana Kashai Dairy Farmers Cooperative Society, and that is where we collect milk from all the members in Kashari. So we are comprised of about 180 members. We get products, we collect milk and market it and sell them to one of the processors. We have also started processing yogurt as a value addition, and we are planning to also have a market size where we can also sell our milk, our yogurt, every part of Uganda. So we're trying that. As a farm, we are trying to also have a big quantity of milk, because now we have around 250 liters of milk per day, and we are planning also to increase on the milk so that we can also compete with other farmers. Our dairy cows, first of all, we have planted hay. We have planted sugar napier. We cut them, make silage, make hay. We have as hay, we make we have Crois Diana, and Crois Diana, we make them hay, we store them so that we can supplement them. We supplement our cows, we give them minerals, vitamins, so that they can increase on their milk production and also be healthy. And give them fresh water. We have big troughs where we can store water from, so that they can, the water that we use is a bit fresh, not like the ones which we use in the dams. The dams and other troughs which are made by clay, no, we don't use that. We use well-furnished, well-made troughs. We have 100 cows, plus the calves, plus the heifers, 110 cows. And we are planning to increase on the cows by making zero grazing. We want to make it a modern farm. We want to start zero grazing, and we are planning in about 3 to 2 years we are going to start a modern farm. So far it's now modern, but we haven't reached on the stage that we want, so we are planning to make, to structure the farm and make it a modern farm where even people can learn from it, because it's near the city and it is strategically located very well. Diversification is very good because you cannot depend on one thing. You cannot depend on dairy farming. So we also planned that we can also have mangoes and banana plantation that can also support the dairy farm. Because when you have your manure, you take it to the banana plantation, and the banana plantation also gives you income so that you can also support the dairy farm. It's good to diversify, and I encourage everyone to diversify. If you have like a farm that has a land, you can try to diversify, do farming, do plantations, so that everything can come with an income, so that you can also support if the production of milk is low, then the banana plantation can help you to pay the workers and people who will, the helpers that help you at the farm. The cow dung that is got from the cows, we take it to the mangoes and to the banana plantation, because this one helps them into manure, right? It gives it nutrition for the banana plantations. And we also, if it becomes a lot, there are some people who want it, who want the cow dung, so we sell them the cow dung. So it's seasonal. There is a time where you take it to the banana plantation, and there is a time when you sell off your cow dung. Longhorn cattle are good, but our main focus was dairy production. We wanted to yield milk, because Frisians and other exotic breeds increase a yield of production of milk. So our main focus was Frisian, because we thought that we can increase on our milk production because of income. That is because when you yield a lot of milk, that is the income that you get. So it's better. We have Ankole cows, but they are not on this farm, but they are on the other farm. But we are mainly focusing on this farm as a dairy productive farm. Our impact on the farm, on the environment, we have given people employment, we have given people jobs. Other people are working, our neighbors, most of them working to the banana plantation, and they get what to eat. The others are working two cows and they get what to eat. So that is the impact that we have given them. We have also given them a good environment, because we maintain our trees and we give them also oxygen for their sustainability. So we have impacted on the good environment to keep the environment clean, and we are trying to also work with the government, on roads, on other things, so that we can also try and keep the environment clean. One of the challenges that we are facing is on the farm is diseases. We have got an outbreak of East Coast fever this season. The other season we had foot and mouth disease. Those are one of the challenges that we have gotten. We also have a challenge of milk price. Our milk price is a bit fluctuating, and it fluctuates a lot, and it doesn't help us as a farmers, because when you yield some milk and you give it to the dairy, they give you little price, and which cannot sustain our farms. So I don't know how we can we are trying to market our prices, but now we have tried to do value addition, but it's still low. So our processors are, the prices are fluctuating, and it's a challenge for the farmers. And we encourage, maybe they can increase our prices so that we can sustain our farms.
Use record keeping
to know how my farm stands, the milk production record, the herd, the cows, how many cows are on the farm, how many cows have we have lost, because it keeps us moving to know how the farm has gone and how the cows are, how the farms are reproducting, because if you know that the cow is about it has six calves, or maybe it has produced more than six cows, so you can know how you can try to maintain it so that you cannot it cannot be old. So you know how to know that these cows are productive. This cow is productive. We do bucket feeding system, so we know how much this calf has taken. This calf, how much we have to see how months, how if it takes 6 months, and we know that that is when we'll remove it on the bucket feeding. I tell all the urban viewers about dairy farming. I want to tell you that everything is tiresome, but you have to try. And if you want to venture into dairy farming, you have to be patient. You have to learn the breeding, the health of cows. You have to also learn on the production of milk, how you can increase on your milk. You have to have a land. That is one of the important things. Land is very important on farming. You have to also know which breeds you're going to use, because breeding is very important in dairy farming. And also, you have to not be a mobile farmer. You have to be on farm so that you can also monitor on how you can maintain your farm and make it a better farm.
Now, this week in our personal finance, we bring to you why you need an emergency fund, and did you know that not all debt is bad? This and a lot more in our month-long series with Johnny Baptist Yahweh.
Investment. We are saying 10% of your income should be invested into things that make sense, that help you generate money both now and into the long run. Remember, we said productive life ends at about 50. And thereafter, consider retirement and let your money be working for you. We also always encourage you to have what we call emergency funds. There are things you may never take care of unless you have planned for them. So have that 10%. it will help you to avoid using excess money on things which I call emergencies. And I always mention, for me, nowadays we tend to contribute for weddings, for funerals, and so many other sorts of things. But I encourage, for me, if you have my 10% set aside, whoever comes first within the month is the one I take care of. Anybody who comes thereafter, I mention, please, not, you're not part of my budget this month, but I'll take care of you next month, and if I must really contribute. So that is the bit of the budgeting I want to bring to your attention. And as a result, you'll find yourself noting that either your budget is balancing or not balancing. If it is not balancing, then you have to move into what we call debt, what we are referring to as borrowing. Now, the borrowing can be both for the business and for you as a person. So my dear colleagues, the business partners, please note, you can still borrow as a business or borrow as a company. It's important to note that there is a difference between a good debt and a bad debt. A good debt, I will start with, is one which we incur with the intention of investing, and so to have a long-term impact on you and your businesses. So the overall financial position should be able to change positively. That's what we call a good debt. A bad debt, many times, is only used to take care of expenses for things which are not really generating income, and as a result, you dig a big hole for yourself. You borrow to pay, until when you cannot run out of that debt. So we encourage that the debt should be used for things that are supposed to help you build your business, generate income in the long run, even when you're not able to take care of you're not able to generate the income yourself directly, but your business should be able to work for you. So what things should be considered when you are borrowing, whether you're a business or an individual? Take note of the interest rates. I know many of us we know every time you think of borrowing, the first thing you say is, what is the interest rate? But please note, interest rates can be measured differently from different financial institutions. So it's not just about the number when you say per annum. Please take note, what is the frequency of that interest rate? What is the number? How is it being computed? How does it relate to your business? Take care of all the other charges that relate to debt. There are other charges which are intrinsic. Whether if a business for an individual, what are they? Do they fluctuate? Does the interest fluctuate? Is it fixed? Does it resonate with the type of business that you are doing? What is the alternatives that you have in terms of financing your business? Put those into context. The other thing you need to take care of is the credit damage. Note that as you consider to borrow, you have a reputation both as an individual and as a business. You have to always fight to have a good credit score, that people know when you borrow, you have the capacity to pay and you indeed pay. That credit record is very important. Then also be mindful of the sustained relationships. Sometimes we borrow. When I talk of borrowing, people think of banks alone, but no. Borrowing starts from right from your home. Many times most of us overlook the cheapest source of income, or borrowing or credit, which are our spouses, our homes, our relatives, our parents. But many times some of us abuse those sources of income by borrowing and not paying. I know there's a famous Kameza money where men tend to leave money for their wives and then they want to borrow, and when they borrow they don't pay back. And then the next time, even when the woman has some money on the side, when the guy asks, can I borrow? The man says, I don't have any money. But guess what? She has the money sitting there. And she's preparing herself for that rainy day when things backfire. And maybe she steps out and she's able to take care of herself. So that is the cheapest source of income. But many times when that is abused, then we shall go to the next layer, which is probably the financial institutions like Standard Chartered. And when you come there, we shall have to assess your credibility, and we encourage you to make sure you have a clean sheet as far as your borrowing and credit behavior is concerned. That is why we have what we call the Credit Reference Bureau, to enable us to assess your willingness or your approach or your appetite towards credit and your type of character that you have towards credit.
Now, the market was stable midweek, with Uganda shilling holding strong against the dollar. The money markets were fairly liquid, according to ABSA. Here now is a full report. now come to the end of our business show tonight. Remember, as a business person, to look out for opportunities to save money in this raging economic crisis. My name is Vailak Sasira. Until next time, good night.